We'll begin. So thank you for joining today. We're going to talk about RightFax Enhancement Packs 2, 4 and 6. These are the last, most recent three versions of RightFax. They're the three versions which are currently in support. And we're going to go through the features that have been added. There's some things that have been taken away as well. So we'll also work our way through those. And it's worth knowing that the previous version went out of support last year, but from a support point of view, if you're running that version, you will still get support on it. But what we don't get is any updates, any enhancements on those versions. So let's have a quick look at the timeline. 10.6, which is the most recent non-supported version, came out in 2013, and it had three feature packs. Now, feature packs added functions and updates. There were service releases too, so we did see add-ons associated with, well, they were mostly, the feature packs were enhancements, whereas service releases were just fixes and patches all wrapped up. And there were probably 10 or 12 service releases in total. But the key thing was that the life cycle of the product started from that 2013. Though the feature packs added new things, they didn't have their own end of life cycle. Now, OpenText for their enterprise products give a life cycle of 5 years. So from release, they go on for 5 years. And you can see there was actually quite a big gap between 10.6 coming out and the release of 16 Enhancement Pack 2. It's also worth saying there was no version 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15. Though, actually, if you look at EP2, and we'll refer to them as EP2, EP4, and EP6 from now onwards, you will actually see that some of the components and some of the executables and things, if you look at the detail against them, they will show that they actually are version 11, because that was probably a decision made before they decided that they would shift it to match the rest of the OpenText Enterprise products. So when we look at these later dates as well, you can assume the life cycle against these. So 2017 was when EP2 was released, and we'd expect that to be supported through to 2022. And we do have another slide about that later on. One of the things about RightFax is that it has continued to be developed. There are new features coming out in each version. There are add-ons that you can buy, not enhancements that go beyond the core functionality. And OpenText seem to be continuing to develop it. Despite the fact they've got cloud solutions and hybrid, they still see the on-premise solution as being a primary product and a product that requires further features. Now, fax is fax, you could say. What's the difference between sending a fax and receiving a fax now as it for 20 years ago? But actually the tools that we have available to manage them, the environments that it's being installed into have changed, and how people use documents has also changed. So as we look across where they've developed the RightFax product, we're going to see lots of themes picked up, and also changes in the market. Things like encryption and security have been enhanced substantially. And that's because if you go back to 2013, there were regulations to do with data privacy and security, but they were probably very, very simple compared with what we have now. Since then, we've had a number of data protection rules around the world, GDPR in the European Union, and MiFID II, which has also come in, both of which have had an impact on users' requirements. So we're going to look first at customer experience. The way this deck will work is that we're going to look at the features that have come in across all the versions against each of the requirements, and against each will show which version it came in on and whether it was a cost add-on. And what you'll see is that most of these additional features were not costed, they were part of the upgrade. And don't forget, if you're paying your maintenance, part of the maintenance is you get the new version. There's no cost for that. Now, you'll have to pay services to do it, to deploy it, but the actual standard version comes in with that agreement. So the first thing to talk about is the new web client. And in fact, we've had two new web clients within this tranche of versions, the 2, 4, and 6. EP2 introduced the new style. So this is the appearance that you see here, this is it's the style is like other open text products. So if you're using other open text products within your business, this will look familiar. It also was the first step towards a feature parity solution with the Fax Util product. And here we're calling it Fax Util Web. That's actually the EP4 name for it. And EP4 and EP6, this is the appearance. It's very feature rich. You will not find any settings or functions in the desktop client, which are not now replicated in the web client. It's a single sign-on. It will work with the latest browsers. So if you're using Chrome or Firefox or Safari, it will function with those. It does work on mobile devices. It hasn't been specifically engineered to be a really slick client on a mobile device, because we know that most users, if they're doing fax mobile, they're probably using email for that. But it does work, and we've successfully done things like scanning documents that are on the table with an iPad or a mobile phone, and you can work it that way. EP4, a new feature was added, which is content search. RightFax has always had, well, for a long time, has had the capability of OCRing the contents of faxes. So what you've been able to do is do a request that a particular received fax is OCR'd. What now you can do is search that content. Now, though we've put this as EP4, it did come on EP4, the searchable content, and it's a cost option. The cost option is only that you need the enterprise version. Now, what you can do is, you say you can search there and then view the facts, and it will highlight the facts within it. And this is a standard viewer. Notice there's now three tabs: image, history, and OCR. And actually, that OCR option, that tab was available on older versions, but now the ability to search has been added. Another thing they've added at EP4 was an enhancement for the viewer. This is in both the web and the desktop client. This adds thumbnails, and you can turn them on and off. So the web and desktop will do this. And if your users are used to not having it, they're not forced to do it. It seems like quite a minor thing. I think most image viewers have had this for 20 years. But this came in with EP4. One of the changes that happened on the final release, Feature Pack 3 of 10.6, was that the view in Fax Util was that you couldn't see all your faxes. So if you had a user with 10,000 faxes, in Fax Util they wouldn't see 10,000. It had it split them by number of pages, so you could have up to 250 faxes per view, but you couldn't view the whole thing. EP2 introduced the ability to search, but it was still a manual process. You would search for each search. Now EP6 has added, not only improved the way you can actually search, but also allowed you to save your searches. So if on a regular basis you do the same search, that will actually be retained on this version. And though it's one of those things that looks like a really minor enhancement, for users that actually handle very large mailboxes, this is a really, really critical enhancement. And for ease of use and for speed of use, it's great. And it's worth saying it works for filters and for search. EP6 has introduced another new feature. Now, this is not a cost feature, but it's almost like they've built a new application within RightFax. RightFax workflows allow you to have a serial set of activities that users will do. So for example, it might be that it's collecting data on an initial release, so validating a document. You can store information against it. We can store text and confirm that it's as we expect it. And it may well be that it's a very simple piece of data that's stored, but you can actually have lots of entries in here to gather lots of information off that document. It can be monitored by Enterprise Fax Manager, and you can see who is progressing them, how long they're taking to go through the system, and also monitor whether users are actually processing their workflows. The workflow client is actually part of Fax Util, whether that be the web util or the desktop util. And to add to that, they've added avatars in the history. Now, this means that after the workflow is complete, you can actually go and look at the history and see who it was that did which part of this. And the additional thing here is that you get nice little pictures of the people. So there we go, little faces, or it will just do a textual icon instead. This works for normal history as well. If you're just looking at the standard history of a fax in a shared mailbox, you will see the avatars of who did what. And they've also added the ability to break out additional data. So if you look at that little entry at the top, you'll see that more could be clicked. Also added to EP6 is automated library documents. Now, it was initially promoted as multi-page cover sheets. Rather than that, what this really is the ability to force a page after the cover sheet. Now, this might be that you want to always have a terms and conditions, or maybe always include a particular form. Perhaps the faxes you're sending need people to fill in a form, which is a disclaimer, perhaps for GDPR or something of that sort. And of course, you can then layer that with other documents in the same way as usual. So in this example, we've got a fax cover sheet, an automated library document, so effectively page 2 of the cover sheet, and then the normal body of the document. And that will process through into a normal fax. There's permissions levels on here. We can control who does it. We can force those to be done, and it's done at a group level. So all members of group can have to have this. So again, a sales team, you might say, well, actually, whenever we send a quote out by fax, we're going to include terms and conditions. We could even be forwarding the special offers that are for the month. So they always go with faxes. I think in practice, what it would be most often used for is forms, a fill-in form where somebody needs to hand fill in that form and fax it back. So EP2, EP4, and EP6 have all made enhancements to this. In the old days, you would not have used Enterprise Fax Manager, the web version. It functioned, but it really wasn't a very good user experience. Now it's been enhanced massively. And this is probably, for most administrators, a better place to administer RightFax than the desktop tool. Of course, you don't need to be on the RightFax server to do it. It controls whether you can stop and start services. You can actually say whether a user is allowed via the web client to manage the services remotely. And they have, by the way, enhanced the full client. And you'll see new things in here. MFPs are now listed. There's also reports embedded in the desktop. And at EP6, this web client also has now the ability to run reports. Now, that was in principle added for people using the managed service. So if you'd like RightFax to host your RightFax server, the hosting solution is multi-server, dedicated infrastructure, highly available, highly resilient, but it's not in your data center and you don't have remote access onto that server. So the web client is made available, the web administration tool, and you can run reports because they are now embedded in the latest version of that client. And as part of that, there are new administrative roles. There used to just be two. You're an administrator and you're an administrator that can bypass privacy. Now, there are several additional options, and these are useful for larger organizations. A read-only administrator may be useful for a support team where they've had an alert, something's happened with RightFax, they want to go in and have a quick look, but they don't know about it. It may be a third party, perhaps a company that manage your data center or do third-party support. So they can be given read-only access. There is also a user-only option. Some organizations will use a different team to manage the server to provisioning of users. And we quite commonly see this where a lot of these activities have been outsourced or offshored. And the problem in the old way of doing it is that you give them access to all the features in RightFax, even though you only want them creating or managing users. So now that has been created as an explicit option. As we said, there is now improved reporting, and that is added into the web client. It's worth adding as well that EP6 also added automated reports, so reports can be generated and popped on the network somewhere. Seems to be lots of features in EP6, doesn't it? That's the current version, of course. So time of day routing is an interesting feature. This allows a fax coming into a particular incoming number to go to different places depending on the time of day. Now, this is one of the things where there are probably some niche use cases. So let's have a quick look at what we've been looking at since the feature was announced. So in the legal sector, you'll often find that there is a primary number for the law firm, and that is the number they're probably served legal documents on. And during the day, that's most commonly printed. So that will be reception or a senior administrator that will pick that up. But out of hours, they don't want that printed. So time of day routing means it can be routed to a different user account and then emailed or notified in some other way. In the health sector, of course, health sectors, they're working around the clock, but actually a lot of teams are still office hour based. So in this scenario, we can say, well, actually out of hours, we'll route to a different user. Maybe somebody's accessing via the web client on the move, perhaps a district nurse or something of that sort. Follow the sun support. Because with RightFax, you can have different rules for how faxes are presented based on a different user. It may be that one team uses fax util, maybe in Europe, but the North American team may be using faxes coming into a network drop, and they'll have an application that picks those up. And perhaps in the Far East, they're using email. That will work very well using this. We still see faxes used for payment instructions, and this would allow for faxes very close to the same day cutoff point to be routed to another team, perhaps to allow a team to go, actually, this one is really critical, this is complicated, it's going to take more time, and to cascade across multiple different user groups. Or it might be, this was my thought, long lunch, siesta. One of those business processes where actually there isn't somebody available for long periods and you want data to go somewhere else. Also added at EP6 is high resolution faxing. This feature request has been around for at least 20 years since I started working with RightFax. People have always said, when are we going to get high res faxing? And it's worth remembering that still a lot of fax machines as default are sending at 100 by 200 dots per inch. Or technically 96 dots per inch by 192 dot per inch, or 203 dot per inch, depending on how they're configured. So there we have very low resolution and now 400 dots per inch. So we've got two comparisons here, 200 dots per inch on the left and 400 on the right. And they're not too different, but if you look at some of the smaller text at the bottom in those rows, you can see that there's a substantial improvement on the 400. So let's zoom in and have a closer look. And again, it's clearer on the right. And if we look at these numbers that were really small, of course the curves look rather better, but more important is that you can see what those numbers are. So if they're, well, this is an eye test, but if it was a prescription and a amount of medication, it would be really critical that that's right. Now, one of the impacts of going to 400 dots per inch is that there is four times as much data. So a fax that normally takes 1 minute might be take as long as 4 minutes per page. A 10-page fax, maybe that takes 10 minutes normally, could be as much as 40 minutes. You can turn this on and turn it off. It's not fixed. You don't have to have this. And it's worth also pointing out that if you use RightFax Connect, rather than having fax boards or SR140 or the OEM version, it's not supported. It's still 200 dots per inch coming out of RightFax Connect. Part of the new client, so it's a new server dashboard. See the status of what's going on. This is quite a simple one. There are alternatives dashboard-wise. We can provide either custom dashboards, but there's also RightFax Analytics. Now, Analytics is a much more in-depth solution around understanding the usage of your fax server. It's a cost option, was introduced first at version EP2 and enhanced further at EP4, and it gives a lot of detail about what's going on. EP4 extended the length of period that the reports will run against, and it actually has its own database. Plenty of information, lots of historic data, and a real long-term guide of what's happening on your server. So let's now talk about changes to, we're calling it business process, but we'll look at particularly security things and how it's deployed in the organization. So this option was added at EP4. This is SIP encryption. It's only going to work, of course, if you have OEM channels on your fax server, OEM faxer IP channels. And it only covers the connection between RightFax and whether it's your telephone system or an SBC or some other outbound facing part. It's not changing anything in the public network. There is actually encryption possible within the T30 and T38 protocols, but they're never really implemented because they're never supported at the other end. This is to protect from internal threats and internal risk. So that element of the call is encrypted. Now, outside in the network, we're not changing anything. But if an internal threat is something that the organization sees as really important, and depending on the data that's being carried and what compliance requirements are being met by the RightFax server being deployed, this may well meet that. It is a per channel license. So if you've got a 16 channel RightFax server, you will need to add 16 licenses, so one per channel. You can't mix and match that. So you can't have 12 of those 16 channels with encryption for them without. Now with an enterprise server, you could move those four to another server and not encrypt them, but on a single server, it's either all encrypted or it's not. Talking of encryption, the RightFax encryption module, actually it was introduced at 10.6, but at 10.6, the encryption level was tripled S. Now that's 192-bit, but overall it wasn't actually that high as a level of security. Now, what this is doing is encrypting faxes at rest. So when they're in either the image folder within the RightFax server, or if it's a shared services system on the shared storage, in a normal deployment, those faxes aren't stored in any secure way. Now, they're not particularly readable. They're stored as CCITT G3 images, and they're a headless TIFF, effectively, that you can't open with a normal image viewer. They weren't open in Photoshop or anything like that. But they are still unencrypted, and they aren't locked to that server. They could be compromised in some way. So the encryption module makes sure that they are encrypted at rest. The connection, the decryption is taking place on the server. It doesn't take place to the client, so there's no keys on the client. And all the key management, and that is all managed by the RightFax server automatically. As we say at EP2, triple desk was replaced with AES 256-bit. Now, one of the things we've seen where users have shared services, this is where you have multiple RightFax servers connecting to a shared database, shared storage, and queues. From 10.6, you had to have resilient MSM queues, Microsoft Message Queuing. Now, that's part of Windows. It's part of a Windows server. But the problem for a lot of people was, though they had resilient SQL and resilient SAN, they didn't have any way of making MSM queue resilient. And again, it was a problem for deployment and a problem for support. In EP6, these queues, they were problematic. And I think that there was a strong enough pushback to say, let's put them somewhere else. Now, they used to be in SQL and they were removed to improve performance, but I think it's generally seen that the performance of databases has improved substantially, and the way those are managed have improved. So now the queues have been put back into the database. It's worth saying that in shared services, you will still have a local copy of MSMQ on each RightFax server, but there is no shared storage for queues. The queues and the list of tasks that the system needs to do are now stored in the database. Now, that isn't a cost option. That was in with EP6 as standard. EP4 introduced another feature around this. So though I just suggested that quite often the sound was replicated. Now we know databases can be replicated data center to data center, but not everybody replicates their storage. That presented a problem with some shared service deployment in that it wasn't easy to replicate the images on that central location. So image high availability added the option of putting the images into a database. Now that meant that the database could be replicated same as the core RightFax database, and images were always available. Now we still actually need some shared storage area, not for fax images, but for other various files, but it's very little in comparison. It's not the whole range of fax images that are stored. This can also be combined with image encryption. So they're stored in a blob table at the moment, and they can also be encrypted. So even if somebody was to access the database, they still couldn't decrypt those. It's as simple as checking a couple of boxes to turn this on as well and select your database, and that will upgrade to RightFax. There are some tools to migrate a current system that perhaps has no encryption and isn't storing the images on a database. So you can actually upgrade those pretty much in flight. At EP4, there was another module that was added as well. So though there's been plenty of solutions for having faxes archived separately, so whether it be Alchemy, and we'll talk about Alchemy very briefly a bit later on, but also other third-party products like FileNet and Highland OnBase, they've had connectors for RightFax. But you've always had to then manage how the permissions work, because you can set up permissions in RightFax to say, well, okay, we'll have restrictions or controls over who can access some shared mailboxes and this sort of thing. But you then had to replicate that out into your document management system. And where a document management system was dedicated for RightFax, you may well find that actually users don't use it an awful lot. And one of the reasons that would happen was that actually it was a feature that you would perhaps go into three or four times a year. You didn't need to go back through historic faxes every day. The RightFax archive module is a separate database, but it's still part of RightFax. So they shifted to a secondary database, and the users still get at the faxes through FaxUtil, but they're not in the main application. So if you are somebody that's processing millions of faxes a year, and that number of faxes on the server becomes a problem, actually shift them to the RightFax archive, and they are still accessible via FaxUtil. The same permissions still apply. Doesn't matter whether you're using FaxUtil web or the desktop client, they can get at historic faxes. So we're now going to talk about external connections. Improvements have been made for connecting the outside world. At EP2, OpenText released a product called the Remote Doc Transport Server. Now, this is hardware. It's the only hardware we're going to talk about today on this presentation. This is a physical server. It's got 8 analog ports, and it can be installed in any location in your network where you've got those analog requirements. So what's the main benefit of it? In some ways, it works like a remote board server. Now, in a normal scenario, let's say that our organization is based within Europe, we may have our collective in Paris, and connections to nearby locations, so we've got Moscow and looks like Sweden there, Oslo, they're going to be pretty good. It would be a fast connection, whether it's OpenText fax gateways, as the pictures are, or whether it's telephone system media gateways, that will be fine. But if we're looking at a further away location like the US or Far East, we then start having performance issues. It's too far away, the latencies are too big, and quality service becomes an issue. So instead, we don't need a real-time connection. This is the thing. These servers will work like a remote doc transport, a traditional installed one. Fax comes into the device and then is routed across as a complete job across to the RightFax collective. That means we can provide a global solution for fax into a single location. And they'll send faxes as well. So it's send and receive. At the moment, there's only an analog solution for this. There is no ISDN type solution. So no E1, T1 or J1 options. But do talk to us if that's something that would be useful to you. Every release of RightFax sees enhancements around multifunction devices. With fax, one of the reasons people are using it is because it's paper. So enhancing and enabling users to walk up to a multifunction printer, multifunction device, and send faxes from that needs to be something that we're constantly keeping an eye on. It's something that will continue to drive fax, because fax is still perceived as paper. And at each release of RightFax, we've seen enhancements here. So what happened at EP2 was that there was a shift to having a common interface. So whether you were stood in front of a Hewlett Packard, a Xerox, a Konica Minolta, it didn't matter what the device brand was, the experience is going to be the same. It was going to have the same user experience. So that means that some of the older interfaces have now been discontinued, but there is that common experience. There is also generally now single sign-on and the option for guests. But if your users are using print management solutions where they're using some form of authentication, a PIN code or a proximity card to log onto their device, they can now go straight into RightFax. It's a cost per device for this solution. So you need to say how many devices do you have that you want to send fax from, and the application needs to be uploaded to the interfaces. It's worth adding that the new one for Konica Minolta has been running a bit behind. So on EP2, it's still the old version. We didn't have one for EP4. Certainly for Europe, there wasn't a functioning interface, but there is for 6. We now have 6 working. We tested it with most of the major print management solutions, and that is available. So if you have Konica Minolta as your print solution, you can now use the new client interface. If you're using RightFax Connect, again, at each release, they have made additional functionality available for administration. This only matters if you've shifted your telephony onto the Connect platform. But at each new release, for some reason, they've aligned the enhancements in the portal with the RightFax releases. Not quite sure that there's any need around that, but they have improved the functionality and made it a more powerful tool for users using Connect. One thing we've known with RightFax is that each new release, we get new features. And one of the key things as well has been adding support for new environments, new versions of things, because things like Microsoft will update their operating systems, their platforms, and also things like the telephone manufacturers and MFD vendors, they are also bringing new things out. So it's a constant challenge to keep up to date. And it is something that RightFax has done very well. Now, one or two other products that still exist in the market have kept up with versions of Windows and stuff of that sort, but they haven't really added any new features. As we've seen, we've had loads of new features. But let's talk about these environment improvements, because they're really critical. So support now for the latest version of Windows 2016, 2019. Office 365 is supported, and RightFax can be installed on Azure or Amazon Web Services. It's worth bearing in mind that there may be limitations around how telephony works in both those environments. So do talk to us before you make the leap there. It might be that the remote dock transport server that we looked at earlier would help with that. It may well be that using RightFax Connect rather than SIP is an option to consider. Or it might be, depending on what other infrastructure is there, that actually you have telephony in the cloud. But deploying into Azure is something which is an AWS is now supported. A few other little things that were added. There has been automated reporting added to the solution. I mentioned there's now web reporting. You can have reports generated daily. They're generated on the server, routed to a folder, and then you can decide what you're going to do with that. We've called it the e-commerce module. Documentation is a bit confusing. It's called both the e-business and the e-commerce module. This allows an organization to have isolated groups, effectively multi-tenanting. Now, it's still one RightFax server. So if you're provisioning for local government, for example, and you're thinking, well, we've got health services, social services, police, and we'd like to put them all onto one big RightFax server, you can do that. But don't forget the RightFax is still going to connect to one platform of telephony. But it is now supported. The e-commerce or e-business module, that adds up to 10 isolated groups. If you want to go beyond 10, you buy another module. So it's like a stackable solution, depending on how many isolated groups you have. There is also phone book only sending. Sending faxes to the wrong location continues to be a concern for lots of organizations, and there are still fines going out to particularly the NHS and local government for sending faxes to the wrong recipients. You can now restrict users to sending only from their phone book, and you can also do what RightFax has had for a long time, which is say, well, hold for release and have somebody else release that document. Google Docs support's also there. We mentioned Office 365. Those are the two main cloud groupware products we're working with these days. And a few more certifications. SAP certification has been updated. So has Cisco. Jitsi is generally not so relevant here in Europe. It's the US Department of Defense standard for, I think they call it Joint Interoperability Test Command. So basically they're checking that it will work with their infrastructure and that it is secure. Though it doesn't matter as a compliance requirement here, the fact that it has met those requirements does say a lot about how RightFax has been architected and how secure it is as a solution. As you can see, we've also got now support for the current versions of Microsoft SQL. I suspect we'll have an update to support 2019 fairly soon as well, though right now it's not officially supported. So we've taken a few features out as well. No support anymore for 2008 R2, no support for 2012 or 2012 R2 for EP6. You can still, of course, deploy EP4, and it's worth saying that any of the versions that are under support, you can upgrade to. So if you're on 10.6 or 10.5 at the moment, you could upgrade to just EP2 or EP4. So if you were thinking, actually, we want to do an on-server upgrade, and we've got Windows 2012 on our current server, you wouldn't go to EP6. EP4 would be your limit. Versions of SQL have also been dropped. EP2 dropped 2005, EP6 has dropped 2008 and 2012. Now, we think that a number of these discontinuations are not because they're not supported by Microsoft, but within the life cycle of the RightFax product, they won't be supported. So the 2012 is due to go end of life in 2022. So with EP6 being supported through to 2024, that would leave support in a very strange position, which is why we think that decision has been made. And there's a couple of others there. Now, the key one here is the COM API. This is really significant. What this means is that any application that was developed using this, and it won't just be applications that you might have developed yourself, some third-party connectors. So for example, if you have the Highland on-base RightFax connector, that uses the COM API. Actually, if you've got OpenText SMTP accelerator, that's not supported going forward either, because that used the COM API as well. So you need to look at how your applications are integrating to RightFax, because anything using the COM API no longer works from EP6. It is no longer supported. Now, there is a new API that's been available for a couple of versions, and a web RESTful web API, which are available for development, but they in principle are no longer supporting anything with the COM API. So let's talk about product lifecycle. So this is kind of the lifecycle document on steroids from what we saw earlier. So as you see, at each release, and we see the release there for EP2 at the top, in the first year, we expect to get 4 service releases. So this is, service releases are kind of indicating that it's under support. So Then it's 2 each year for the next 4 years, and then it goes into sustaining maintenance. As a product goes to sustaining maintenance, it is still supported. Process flow support can still escalate issues to the manufacturer, and they can still validate that it is a fault or a bug, but they're not going to fix it. We will only get patches and updates and fixes on versions that are supported. Now, the other thing we've put on here is future versions. This is the ongoing cycle that OpenText have. OpenText actually have 2 release windows per year. Obviously, odd numbers as well, which are an autumn release. For RightFax, there's only a single release scheduled for the next few years. Now, the other thing that's also happening is, at the moment, all enterprise products from OpenText are version 16. We think from next year that they will actually be maybe called version 20. So we think next year, Q2, we'll probably see RightFax 20 EP2. It's just the next version, RightFax.next. Now, we've only had limited time today. There are release documents for each version, and there are loads and loads of things, and I have only really skimmed the surface. And from our point of view, this is really good. RightFax continues to be developed. It continues to have enhancements, new features, and OpenText do respond to requests for improvements. And it does seem like they have a long-term goal still to develop this, even though they are developing their cloud solutions and their hybrid platforms. So as regards protecting your investment with RightFax, it does seem to be that you've made a good choice. It has a long-term life as a product. So we'll send out a link after this in a few days, so you can watch the video again or share it with a colleague. And do feel free to contact ProcessFlows and talk about any of these issues. If you'd like to do this for other colleagues in your organization, or if you're a reseller for any of your customers, again, we can do that, and we can customize this to cover the areas that are relevant for your needs. So thank you very much. Thank you for your time today, and we will see you next time.